I don't know. We'll figure it out. We'll get to that later. Today, we're gonna update on every freshwater aquarium. There's just too much to show and talk about, so I gotta do it all in one video so we can actually progress with other things. But before we get to that, I have a weird confession to make. And it definitely is gonna sound weird, but I don't like making YouTube videos anymore. It definitely sounds a lot weirder than I thought it was going to be, but let me explain. Remember when the gallery first started? I used to make like videos that were one-off, a certain project or a certain idea or a certain thing, and I'd make them once a week. But once the gallery began, there was far too much to talk about and show, so I started like vlogging and doing daily, almost daily uploads, and I gotta admit, that was the single most happiest time in my 14-year-long YouTube career. And the simple fact of the matter is this, it felt like I was bringing you guys along with my hobby, and you guys were so involved. And you know, then life happened, a pandemic happened, and I went back to like making videos every once in a while about a certain subject, etc. But I always found like I don't really want to make the video. I don't really know what I want to talk about or show. And should I make a video about this? It's a project, but does it deserve to be a featured video, etc., etc. And I thought to myself, I'm putting too much thought into this. And I just kind of stopped making videos. I mean, I only do this because I love to do it. I only make videos because I enjoy it. And I've said it many times, I'll stop making videos when I'm no longer having fun. And the time has come, I'm no longer having fun making the videos. I'm still having a blast with my hobby. I just ruined my channel. So here's what I propose. We go back to the old Joey and the old community that we used to have, the DIY fish keepers. But I'm gonna need your help. I need to know that you guys want me to go back to that. Otherwise, I'll just slip off into oblivion and go back to doing what I do all by myself without a camera. Because I got to admit, I'm not as comfortable as I used to be on camera. I'm not I just want to go back to bringing you guys along. Like having a friend here with me, and I'm showing them and talking to them and being excited with me, etc. The way you guys can let me know, if this video gets 10,000 likes, let me know, as well as let me know in the comment section if you want me to go back to the old Joey. I really want to. And I guess a lot of you guys are going to say, if you really want it, just do it. But I kind of need that validation from the community that we've created. And I know what you guys are going to say. And I know you guys will be excited. And I got to admit, I am too. I'm excited to go back to like showing you everything, all the thought process and up to even the smallest little things, because there's always something and I'm always doing something. I'm like, oh no, that's not good enough for a video. No, I can't make a video out of that. Or because the channel got so big at one point that it was intimidating to me, like, oh, this doesn't deserve to go on camera, or this isn't cool enough or a huge enough or big enough project. And that's just not who I am, and that's not who I ever was. I mean, it was really cool. 10,000 likes, we go back. I know a lot of people, some people don't like those rants, but man, that felt really good to say. And to be honest with you, I know you guys are gonna be there for me. I know you're gonna support me. I already know the outcome of this, and I'm excited, and I know you guys are too. Let's do this. Okay, let's talk about fish. Let's show the fish. Half of you guys are probably not even watching right now. Like, oh damn, Joey's being emotional again. I can't help it, I'm a human. I swear, these plants are growing every time I come back out here. Look at the trees in the back, in the piranha tank. Absolutely phenomenal growth, just incredible. I'm getting worried that I'm gonna have to prune, but I'm going to leave it alone. And I'm gonna leave it alone for a simple reason. We are adding in another 16 piranha into this aquarium, doubling the number that's in it right now. If you don't know, we have 16 red-belly piranha, as well as 140 red-eyed tetras. Let's see if we can focus on a couple of them. A lot of people ask if these are baby piranha. They're not, they're just red-eyed tetras. As you can see, they're acting normal. I've seen comments where people are like, oh, these fish are going to be living in fear. They don't know that those are piranha. They swim amongst them. The piranha do not see them as a food source. They're too small and require too much energy to chase around just for a little snack. So there's the same amount that was in there as before. I mean, obviously I can't count them all, but as you can see, they're like everywhere in the tank. They're all through the back. They're all in the front. They'll even swim down with the piranha. I'm building a filter for this tank shortly, and it's going to go into the other room. Right now, the other room's kind of like a quarantine area for new fish, but I'm also thinking about converting my utility room, which is just a personal fish room right now, into another, like a publicly viewable fish room for you guys, like YouTube. So we'll see where that goes. Of course, that's something that we could discuss on the vlog if we go back to that, which, well, we're going back to that anyways. Let's take a look. Anyways, the baby piranha are over here, and they're not really babies. They're just not big enough to go in with the adults, in my opinion. So these guys are about half the size. But I really want to use this tank to turn it into a fancy goldfish aquarium. I want the rocks kind of piled up the same, but I do want to add in some tall fake plants and maybe add in like 10 to 15 fancy goldfish. But we do face a problem in doing that. First and foremost, will the adults eat them if I move them too soon? It's a gamble. It is their species. They do look similar in appearance. I could test it by adding one or two, but if I put one or two in, they'll definitely become targets. My best bet is to feed the entire aquarium, get these guys in the tank, but lower them into an area where the adults can't see them. They're not even adults. They're still like adolescents. And take that risk. Or we have to grow them out maybe for another 6 months to a year. And by that time, let me know your guys' thoughts on that. It's a risky situation, but is it? Anyways, this is a salinity tester, but it also shows temperature. So if I turn it on here, if you guys can even see it, what's it saying now? Battery's at 97%, salinity's at 1. But anyways, it'll also measure the temperature of the water. So for example, I could put it in the lake tank, eco tank that we're gonna look at in a minute, and we can see now that the temperature of this tank, it keeps rising. The frontos are coming over to me right now. They're going to bite me. It's about 26. 26.1. I lied. Salinity, of course, is 0. And then, of course, the piranha aquarium. Hopefully these guys don't bite me. Now, what we're going to notice is the temperature is much higher. Goes up to about 27.5, maybe 0.6. Yeah. 27.6 up here, 26, whatever it was. You can tell it's about a degree of a Celsius difference. And that fluctuates between every aquarium, especially over here. The discus tank is about 26. This one's about 27. Every tank above up here is a little warmer than everything else. And I think you guys know where we're going with this. Hot air rises. But here's something interesting. This is the controller for the room. I keep the temperature at 24 degrees Celsius. Why is everything so much warmer than the room's temperature? It's been about 24 degrees Celsius out here since the summer began. I heat the gallery. I don't heat individual tanks. It would take thousands upon thousands of watts to heat everything versus a heat pump, which is only turns on and only keeps the room at a certain temperature. It's a far more efficient way of heating a ton of aquariums. Heat the room, not the tanks. But why is it 24 and the tanks are like 26 to, let's say, 28? It's like the greenhouse effect. When you have a greenhouse, you're growing plants. A lot of the times they'll take 55-gallon barrels that warm up throughout the day. And then kind of when the sun goes down, they continue to heat the greenhouse up. And that's essentially what's happening out here as well. All the tanks are kind of warming up all the time and keeping the room at a consistent and constant temperature. Even with a massive air exchanger that's rated for, I think, 6 times the size of this building, it was about a month or two ago that I kept the temperature out here at around 26, 27 because it was colder outside. But now with the winter or the summer here, I lower the inside temperature and these tanks almost heat the room consistently. They're supposed to go back to regular temperature eventually, though, aren't they? Well, all of these pumps inside the aquariums, and even this one has one, you can see its reflection right there, are also contributing to heating the tanks and keeping them a little bit up in temperature. So I always kind of mess around with the ambient temperature to see how low I can lower it before the tank temperatures get a little too chilly. Anyways, what I'm talking about when it comes to the goldfish is simple. This tank is just too warm. It's like 27, 28, and I know some people will be like, well, you can add a chiller. High humidity, warm temperature, cold container. Do you ever take a glass of water, a nice cold glass of water, bring it out on a hot sunny day, and it just turns into, it looks like the glass is melting, all that condensation all over it? That's all the tank would look like. So if I wanted to keep goldfish up here, I'd have to lower the entire temperature in the gallery. The bottom tanks would have to come down to like 23, so this tank could be 24. The only other option is maybe put them in a small... We'll see what happens. But it wouldn't be the first time that I kept fancy goldfish at warmer temperatures with extreme success. Let me know your thoughts on that and what do you think I should do with that situation. We got to go back to daily vlogging so we could talk. Anyways, the Lake Tanganyika Aquarium. This aquarium is the single most untouched fish tank that I have. And what I mean by that is I simply don't put my hands in it. I don't gravel vacuum. Oh, we've got some arguing. I don't gravel vacuum it. I don't clean the algae. I sometimes clean the glass, the front of it, with some that Fritz glass and acrylic cleaner. But the inside, sometimes I'll take the algae off. But I don't touch this tank at all. It's like the single most left alone tank that I have. I think it's been running for about a year or two now, I'm not sure. But if you guys don't remember, we have, and you can see all the shells over here, which a lot of people ask me where I get these shells. I just got them on Amazon. You can look, they're escargot shells, nothing fancy. But there's a ton of shell dwellers in here. A lot of people thought, no, there's no way they make it. They're not gonna last with the Frontosa, et cetera, et cetera. But they're all in here. They're all having babies. There's babies everywhere in here. And for the most part, when this population explodes in terms of like there's too many males, they start moving over here and over here. I didn't put these shells here. These tiny little fish moved them from here all the way over there. You guys remember when I set this tank up? There is some brush algae, a different types of algae in this tank as well, which I leave alone. The problem with this though is the frontosa are getting big and I have too many males. Even right here, I see one big male back here. You can tell by their nuchal humps a lot of the times and sometimes their finnage and whatnot, but there's a massive male back there. Not this one, but the one behind him. I'll get them to come out, I'll feed them. I don't do this a lot, but I'm gonna give them like a little cube of bloodworm. I don't feed a lot of bloodworm, although there's a lot here, I'll show you. Freezer, we have my discus food. We'll see them in a little bit. This is beef heart, peas, spirulina. I've got a few sheets of that left. If we look under there, a few sheets right there. This lasts damn near a month. Sorry for cursing. Lots of bloodworms. That's bloodworms. Brine shrimp. More brine shrimp back there. Sorry, I don't know if you can see. More brine shrimp back there, but that's for the seahorses. And this is the mix I make for... I feed one of these a day, sometimes two. It's about a half pound of food for all the big guys, and it's got tilapia and mussels and scallops and shrimp. But anyways, I don't feed bloodworm a lot for a simple reason. A lot of the times the fish can't digest the skins on the bloodworms. It's a treat. It's not a staple food, especially if you have a fish that won't eat. A lot of times they'll eat bloodworm, but a lot of people like to feed it because their fish goes nuts, but it can cause internal issues with the fish. Again, it has everything to do with the fact that they can't digest it. Look, they're already all coming over. And yeah, maybe they can, you'll never have problems with this or at times, but it can cause internal blockages if you feed it a little too much. See the pack of Frontosa? So we have your regular Frontosa, and then we have the clouded ones. I'm trying to get the big male to come out. He's always over in that corner. He'll come out in a minute. I don't know how he's that big. I do try to feed him a little extra. Here he comes. Now this is the size difference. Where'd he go? That big bugger. See him right there? That's him. He just absolutely dominates the size of everybody else. So he's clearly the dominant male. So what I need to do, and it's going to be unfortunate, is if I want this aquarium to last long term, I'm going to have to take out everything. Why? So I can catch him and catch everybody else. Oops, sorry. Yeah, Frontosa could be so fun. They're just skittish at times, which is weird because they'll eat out of my hands and I can pet them and all kinds of stuff. But if we go back to vlogging, we'll be able to see, like, instead of these one-off updates every 6 months on a tank that you guys love, we'll be able to see it almost every day. But in order to catch them and sex them properly, put in one male with, say, five females, and then the shell dwellers can remain. But man, they are just he's just a monster. In comparison to everybody else, I'd suggest he's probably about 8 inches, and everybody else is, I don't know, 3 to 6. Yeah, just beautiful. So what I'd actually like to do, and this is a fun idea, is because he's a regular frontosa, I'd like to, it looks like a lot of the clouded ones, like, so you have the regular stripes, right? And then you got these clouded ones. I think that's what they're called. I forget what they're called. Ghosts or something, I don't know. But it looks like most of those are females. So we could probably cross them to the male, because all the other ones look to be mostly males. Although it's not gonna matter, the more the better. But yeah, so another reason is some of the males, like this guy here, look at his fins. He's taking a bit of a beating every once in a while by going back there with Big Daddy. That must be his woman. She might even have fry in her mouth because she's not eating. But yeah, these guys are getting to breeding size for sure. And they are a mouth broder, so it'd be absolutely fascinating to watch. But again, that's another update for another time. Okay, so that's that two tanks. We're just gonna focus on the freshwater tanks for right now, because saltwater needs its own update. A lot has been going on. A lot of fun, really cool things. I gotta shut off the ambient lights. I don't know if it'll make a difference. No, just the reflection. So this is the brackish water tank. Technically, it's back to being full freshwater. For no apparent reason other than I forgot to do a water change with brackish water and maintain the salinity. I was really busy for a couple of weeks and I did two water changes and this tank went back to fresh water. So that kind of sucked. There's probably some trace amounts of salt in there, but to be honest, not a lot. One of the things that I was thinking about though is you could see with the archers and whatnot, the archers haven't really put on a ton of size, but you guys have seen them less than me. It's really hard to gauge your fish's size if you see them every single day, but you guys don't, so maybe you'll be able to notice that they're a lot smaller, or sorry, a lot bigger. They don't go back in size, but monos are beautiful. Scats are doing really well, but one of the things I was thinking is because I am building a 2,000 gallon filter, like it's actively happening outside, I'm thinking about putting them up in the 375 just to grow them out even more for a while. Maybe they go in the 375 event or in the 2000 eventually, but we'll get to that. I don't know. I always think about these crazy things every once in a while, but yeah, everybody's doing absolutely fantastic. By far, the scats are my favorite. But then I look at the monos and I'm like, damn, these guys are so unique, so cool. And then of course I look at the archers and I'm like, wow, you know, I just love their unique abilities and whatnot. But so, for me, it's really hard to decide what's what in here. Ooh, you look like you got beat up a little bit. You'll live. Tyrese and his homies. Ugh, close this door, window. I'm starting to think that the Festivum are the world's slowest growing fish. I don't really feel like they've gotten any bigger since I've got them. And it's a little frustrating because I would love the Festivums to go in the 2000 because they are a South American fish. Angels are just such a slow moving fish, they never could. But look how many Festivums we have. And aren't they super cool? It's like a schooling, cichlid, but a lot of cichlids will school from South America and Central America. You typically don't see that, but a lot of times we don't keep them in tanks big enough or in numbers that they would typically enjoy in the wild. If you've ever seen Oscars, for example, swimming in the wild, they're always together and they will school. But Tyrese just a happy, happy, happy boy. Yeah, he loves it in there. No, he hasn't attacked anybody, done anything. He's been in there months now, but he's always had tank mates. So it goes to show, like, sometimes things will work for you, sometimes they won't. Sometimes they'll work for other people and they won't work for you. But one of the best things you could do for a pahaka is, from a young age, keep them with other fish. Anyways, the Oscars, I bet we'll just look in here and they'll be together. Or at least roughly. At nighttime, they're all down in this corner, grouping up, hanging out together. One of the things that I really love about the Oscars, especially tigers, like, oh man, he's beautiful. He's a gorgeous, gorgeous fish. One of his pectorals are torn up, but there's no secondary infection. It's just fighting and whatnot. Oscars will do that. Look at the Severums in perfect condition. Let me change the lighting on this for you guys. There you go. Now we can see the fish. It's almost like I had to turn the lights on. The Arowana is just stunning. Stunningly, stunningly beautiful. A lot of tannins in this water though. And that's a lot to do with all that wood in the back that's jumbled up. But ever since I added that, it gave everybody places to hide. Look, the Bicher's right under there if you can see them. I'm gonna switch lenses. There he is, right there. And he enjoys it. Look at the gorgeous, gorgeous coloration on these guys. So we've talked about this before. This is a male Sevrum. It's not because he's pretty. Look at his cheeks. They're so easy to sex at this size. And then we can look at a female in her breeding dress. What's wrong with her cheeks? Look at this guy's cheeks. It's literally on their gills, their gill plates. What's the difference? There's a female, there's a male. The males have the squiggly marks. The females simply do not. And that's true for all of the colored Sevrums. And I mean the Rotkeels and the greens, and you know, more the wild types. But yeah, these guys are just absolutely phenomenally beautiful fish. Very graceful, not very aggressive. Really incredible when they get older. They will get a little fatter and wider and be more of a, you know, boisterous size. Probably get to the size of what the Oscar is right now, which is, I don't know, 8, 10 inches or something like that. But look who dwarfs everybody. There can be only one. Yeah, absolutely beautiful. I love this tank. I love that we did put in the Oscars. I was questioning the Sevrums because I was worried because they are not always, always out. But as you can see right now, I think there's six out. I think we added 9. Oh, I guess there's another one in the back there. They're all in here. I never really have to scoop anybody out. Aren't you a pretty little girl? Yeah, one of the things with the Oscars, though, is they change coloration all the time based on their moods. It's almost like you get a different fish every other day. So colored up like this, you see he's more pale, more green. He's stressed or he's hungry. He's upset. He's emotional. They get hangry. Same with him. Look at that. Then we look at, let me see somebody who's darker, where their black dot blotches get really black or really dark. Super happy. Content. But yeah, this tank's waiting to eat. The rays are still rays. They haven't changed. Getting bigger. Of course, they're all over a foot across. For future reference, these tiles, for example, are 2 feet long and 1 foot wide. So they're 2x1. And obviously the female here, that's a big female, is the largest. And then one of the other females is the second largest. And then we got the male, which is this one right here. Let me make sure. No, it's you over there. Yeah, so he's got the claspers behind him. As you can see, he's just simply not sexually mature. So a lot of people are asking, when are your rays gonna breed? When are your rays gonna breed? I don't know, whenever he decides that he's sexually mature enough to do it. The Bicher came out, it sees me. So Bichers can be incredibly friendly, and the older they get, the more outgoing they will become. But they do need a bit of a hiding place. As you can see, everybody else kind of doesn't. The rays do like to forage in the wood and whatnot, but the Oscars, for the most part, don't need much. Sevrums do need a bit of hiding. So this is a great tank for them. And everybody in it is doing absolutely phenomenal. Now for a tank that's been really upsetting me, but I'm going to have to make a video of it all on its own because I've been documenting it for 2 months. Remember the natural discus aquarium? Get a breeding pair of discus, put them in a 180 gallon tank and let them do their thing naturally. Yeah, that seemed like a fun, great idea because I always bred them professionally. I set up a breeding tank and grow out tanks, and everything was like an assembly line, and we were incredibly successful with it. But these guys, see if we can even see them in here. It is a dark tank and they're a little shy right now. I don't know why. They'll eat out of my hand too. Yeah, I'm not gonna mess with them too much. But they bred 9 times in here now. And they always breed on the intake of this little canister filter that I tossed on here. So I did put a sponge over it. I've documented all of this. I wanted them to stop laying on that, and kind of wanted them to go back to the way I used to breed them, which is on a PVC pipe. So I put that in there and they still wouldn't breed on it. So they kept breeding on this and they keep eating the eggs. So then I put some mesh around it and then they just abandoned the eggs entirely and completely. So what I'm going to do is, I think the tank is just too dark for them. I think one other option is to put some white bristle board behind that, because that is just a black wall. It's not painted or anything like that. So I could put some white bristle board behind that, brighten it up a bit, because that's one of the only things that, is missing from this tank in terms of, you know, how I used to do things versus it is now. And then finally, I also changed their diet. I got them on my breeding food diet. So not everything's completely natural. I am interfering slightly, but the other option is to put them in a smaller tank. Discus will breed more readily in a 30 gallon, for example, or a 40 gallon versus, you know, 180 gallon tank. They might not feel secure enough. And I think that even at nighttime, when I leave the lights on, not the main light, but I'll put a light near the tank and it lights it up nice so they can still see their eggs and whatnot. The eggs last for 2 days and I think they're eating them at wiggler stage, but I think it's because they just don't feel secure in this tank. And so I'm going to make some changes there. And I think we will likely go towards, you know, breeding them the way I used to. And then once we have all the fry, say we get 40, 50, we'll put them in the tank, something like that. But they are beautiful, aren't they? They usually don't hide like this, but I think me opening the curtain and shoving a camera in their face is kind of making them overreact. Okay, so that's all the freshwater tanks that I kind of want to show you for today. I really want to get back. Well, I'll show you what I'm doing outside. Currently just rinsing off the sponges here. We're going to be using them all. They're really filthy. I don't know if I'm going to end up using them, but they're from older pond filters. That's the gallery right there. I don't know if you can see my reflection in there, but that's the 700. This is that old cylinder tank, 100 gallons, and I'm going to turn it into a fluidized filter that also incorporates really good mechanical filtration into it, because we already have all the fluidized media. I don't know if this even, you can even see all this, is so bright out right now. But I want to make sure, first and foremost, that I have all the plumbing parts before I get started, start drilling and commit to the idea, because once I start, I can't stop. And if I can't finish it, I get anxiety, I can't sleep, I just can't stop thinking about it. So I'm just kind of playing around with ideas of what I want to do. Some people have said, because I've shown this before, especially to the members only, about using this cylinder tank, and some people are like, just use one of your big 55 gallon barrels. Well, this is 100 gallons, plus we can see into it. Plus it's really, really badly scratched everywhere. So I don't ever see using this as an actual fish tank again. I might as well build something cool out of it and build a, you know, a large fluidized filter. You guys remember like back in the day, we built these all the time. And, but yeah, the 2000 needs this. And then I think for the 700, when I build a filter for that, I'm likely going to take one of the, spare 40 gallon tanks, because this tank just needs more biological filtration, and mechanical. It's a little cloudy sometimes, but that has everything to do with the filtration, the mechanical portion of it, which is a large canister filter, but I believe the media is just degrading slowly because I've been using it for 6 years, possibly even longer. And if I backwash the filter, it clouds this up completely when it starts back up. So I think that we're just going to go with something else. Maybe I'll do a 55 gallon barrel for it or something like that. But again, that's something we'll discuss in future videos. If we begin vlogging again, all you gotta do is make sure you click the like button, get me to make me feel good about myself that I'm making the right decisions. It's kind of like we're kind of vlogging right now, but not really doing anything. I'm just showing you stuff. I kind of really wanna bring you guys along for the actual day-to-day, you know, maintenance and feeding and things that I'm building and, you know, future things and bringing to the stores and all that stuff. And if you guys wanna see those types of videos, make sure you subscribe. Click the like button and comment below that Joey, go back to the old Joey. If you haven't noticed, I even went back to shaving my head. Like, I got sick of everything. I was so upset with everything. Like, I was like, well, I'm getting older. I was like, well, maybe I should grow my hair out a little bit while I still can. And then I grew it out and I did it for 2 years and I hated every minute of it. Like, I'd wake up, my hair is all messed up, and I was like, I don't want to deal with the hair. So zoop, shaved it off myself, and I still do to this day. I'm going back to the way things used to be, and I'm bringing you with me.
I forgot, I'm gonna need a thumbnail. I used to like put effort into them. Not really. I used to have like classic thumbnails. One of them was this.
All my fish. Look at my fish tanks. Remember I said, stand in front of a big tank and go.
Then everybody started doing it, and ruined it, so I stopped. No, this is the thumbnail this time though. I'm back!